The Stolen Cigar Case. By Bret Harte. By A. Condle. I found Hemlock Jones in the old Brook Street lodgings, musing before the fire. With the freedom of an old friend, I at once threw myself in my usual familiar attitude at his feet, and gently caressed his boot. I was induced to do this for two reasons: one, that it enabled me to get a good look at his bent, concentrated face, and the other, that it seemed to indicate my reverence for his superhuman insight. So absorbed was he even then, in tracking some mysterious clue, that he did not seem to notice me. But therein I was wrong, as I always was in my attempt to understand that powerful intellect. "It is raining," he said, without lifting his head. "You have been out, then?" I said quickly. "No. But I see that your umbrella is wet, and that your overcoat has drops of water on it." I sat aghast at his penetration. After a pause he said carelessly, as if dismissing the subject, "Besides, I hear the rain on the window." "Listen." I listened. I could scarcely credit my ears, but there was the soft pattering of drops on the panes. It was evident there was no deceiving this man. "Have you been busy lately?" I asked, changing the subject. "What new problem, given up by Scotland Yard as inscrutable, has occupied that gigantic intellect?" He drew back his foot slightly, and seemed to hesitate ere he returned it to its original position. Then he answered wearily, "Mere trifles, nothing to speak of. The Prince Kupoli has been here to get my advice regarding the disappearance of certain rubies from the Kremlin. The Rajah of Puttibad, after vainly beheading his entire bodyguard, has been obliged to seek my assistance to recover a jeweled sword. The Grand Duchess of Pretzelbrunswick is desirous of discovering where her husband was on the night of February 14th, and last night," he lowered his voice slightly, "a lodger in this very house, meeting me on the stairs, wanted to know why they didn't answer his bell." I could not help smiling until I saw a frown gathering on his inscrutable forehead. "Pray remember," he said coldly, "that it was through such an apparently trivial question that I found out why Paul Farrell killed his wife, and what happened to Jones. I became dumb at once." He paused for a moment, and then suddenly changing back to his usual pitiless, analytical style, he said, "When I say these are trifles, they are so in comparison to an affair that is now before me. A crime has been committed and, singularly enough, against myself." "You start," he said. "You wonder who would have dared to attempt it?" "So did I. Nevertheless, it has been done. I have been robbed." "You robbed?" "You, Hemlock Jones, the terror of peculiarities." I gasped in amazement, arising and gripping the table as I faced him. "Yes. Listen. I would confess it to no other. But you, who have followed my career, who know my methods, you, for whom I have partly lifted the veil that conceals my plans from ordinary humanity, you, who have for years rapturously accepted my confidences, passionately admired my inductions and inferences, placed yourself at my beck and call, become my slave, groveled at my feet, given up your practice except those few unremunerative and rapidly decreasing patients to whom, in moments of abstraction over my problems, you have administered strychnine for quinine and arsenic for Epsom salts, you, who have sacrificed anything and everybody to me, you I make my confidant." I arose and embraced him warmly, yet he was already so engrossed in thought that at the same moment he mechanically placed his hand upon his watch chain as if to consult the time. "Sit down," he said. "Have a cigar." "I have given up cigar smoking," I said. "Why?" he asked. I hesitated, and perhaps colored. I had really given it up because, with my diminished practice, it was too expensive. I could afford only a pipe. "I prefer a pipe," I said laughingly. "But tell me of this robbery. What have you lost?" He arose, and planting himself before the fire with his hands under his coat tails, looked down upon me reflectively for a moment. "Do you remember the cigar case presented to me by the Turkish ambassador for discovering the missing favorite of the Grand Vizier in the Fifth Chorus Girl at the Hilarity Theater? It was that one. I mean the cigar case. It was increased usted with diamonds. And the largest one had been supplanted by paste, I said.
Ah, he said, with a reflective smile, you know that.
You told me yourself. I remember considering it a proof of your extraordinary perception.
But, by Jove, you don't mean to say you have lost it?
He was silent for a moment.
No, it has been stolen, it is true, but I shall still find it.
And by myself alone.
In your profession, my dear fellow, when a member is seriously ill, he does not prescribe for himself, but calls in a brother doctor.
Therein we differ.
I shall take this matter in my own hands.
And where could you find better?
I said enthusiastically.
I should say the cigar case is as good as recovered already.
I shall remind you of that again, he said lightly.
And now, to show you my confidence in your judgment, in spite of my determination to pursue this alone, I am willing to listen to any suggestions from you.
He drew a memorandum book from his pocket and, with a grave smile, took up his pencil.
I could scarcely believe my senses.
He, the great Hemlock Jones, accepting suggestions from a humble individual like myself.
I kissed his hand reverently, and began in a joyous tone.
First, I should advertise, offering a reward, I should give the same intimation in handbills, distributed at the pubs and the pastry cooks.
I should next visit the different pawnbrokers, I should give notice at the police station.
I should examine the servants.
I should thoroughly search the house and my own pockets.
I speak relatively, I added, with a laugh.
Of course I mean your own.
He gravely made an entry of these details.
Perhaps, I added, you have already done this.
Perhaps, he returned enigmatically.
Now, my dear friend, he continued, putting the notebook in his pocket and rising, would you excuse me for a few moments?
Make yourself perfectly at home until I return, there may be some things, he added with a sweep of his hand toward his heterogeneously filled shelves, that may interest you and while away the time.
There are pipes and tobacco in that corner.
Then nodding to me with the same inscrutable face he left the room.
I was too well accustomed to his methods to think much of his unceremonious withdrawal, and made no doubt he was off to investigate some clue which had suddenly occurred to his active intelligence.
Left to myself, I cast a cursory glance over his shelves.
There were a number of small glass jars containing earthy substances, labeled pavement and road sweepings, from the principal thoroughfares and suburbs of London, with the sub-directions for identifying foot tracks.
There were several other jars, labeled fluff from omnibus and road car seats, coconut fiber and rope strands from mattings in public places, cigarette stumps and match ends from floor of Palace Theatre, Row A, 1-50.
Everywhere were evidences of this wonderful man's system and perspicacity.
I was thus engaged when I heard the slight creaking of a door, and I looked up as a stranger entered.
He was a rough-looking man, with a shabby overcoat and a still more disreputable muffler around his throat and the lower part of his face. Considerably annoyed at his intrusion, I turned upon him rather sharply, when, with a mumbled, growling apology for mistaking the room, he shuffled out again and closed the door.
I followed him quickly to the landing and saw that he disappeared down the stairs.
With my mind full of the robbery, the incident made a singular impression upon me.
I knew my friend's habit of hasty absences from his room in his moments of deep inspiration. It was only too probable that, with his powerful intellect and magnificent perceptive genius concentrated on one subject, he should be careless of his own belongings, and no doubt even forget to take the ordinary precaution of locking up his drawers.
I tried one or two and found that I was right, although for some reason I was unable to open one to its fullest extent.
The handles were sticky, as if someone had opened them with dirty fingers.
Knowing Hemlock's fastidious cleanliness, I resolved to inform him of this circumstance, but I forgot it, alas.
Until but I am anticipating my story.
His absence was strangely prolonged.
I at last seated myself by the fire, and lulled by warmth and the patter of the rain on the window, I fell asleep. I may have dreamt, for during my sleep I had a vague semi-consciousness as of hands being softly pressed on my pockets, no doubt induced by the story of the robbery. When I came fully to my senses, I found Hemlock Jones sitting on the other side of the hearth, his deeply concentrated gaze fixed on the fire. "I found you so comfortably asleep that I could not bear to awaken you," he said, with a smile. I rubbed my eyes.
"And what news?"
I asked. "How have you succeeded?"
"Better than I expected," he said, "and I think," he added, tapping his notebook, "I owe much to you."
Deeply gratified, I awaited more. But in vain. I ought to have remembered that in his moods Hemlock Jones was reticence itself. I told him simply of the strange intrusion, but he only laughed. Later, when I arose to go, he looked at me playfully.
"If you were a married man," he said, "I would advise you not to go home until you had brushed your sleeve. There are a few short brown sealskin hairs on the inner side of your forearm, just where they would have adhered if your arm had encircled a sealskin coat with some pressure. For once you are at fault," I said triumphantly, "the hair is my own, as you will perceive. I have just had it cut at the hairdresser's, and no doubt this arm projected beyond the apron." He frowned slightly, yet, nevertheless, on my turning to go he embraced me warmly, a rare exhibition in that man of ice. He even helped me on with my overcoat and pulled out and smoothed down the flaps of my pockets. He was particular, too, in fitting my arm in my overcoat sleeve, shaking the sleeve down from the armhole to the cuff with his deft fingers. "Come again soon," he said, clapping me on the back. "At any and all times," I said enthusiastically. "I only ask 10 minutes twice a day to eat a crust at my office, and 4 hours sleep at night, and the rest of my time is devoted to you always, as you know."
"It is indeed," he said, with his impenetrable smile. Nevertheless, I did not find him at home when I next called. One afternoon, when nearing my own home, I met him in one of his favorite disguises, a long blue swallow-tailed coat, striped cotton trousers, large turnover collar, black face, and white hat, carrying a tambourine. Of course, to others the disguise was perfect, although it was known to myself, and I passed him according to an old understanding between us without the slightest recognition, trusting to a later explanation. At another time, as I was making a professional visit to the wife of a publican at the East End, I saw him, in the disguise of a broken-down artisan, looking into the window of an adjacent pawn shop. I was delighted to see that he was evidently following my suggestions, and in my joy I ventured to tip him a wink. It was abstractedly returned. 2 days later I received a note appointing a meeting at his lodgings that night. That meeting, alas, was the one memorable occurrence of my life, and the last meeting I ever had with Hemlock Jones. I will try to set it down calmly, though my pulses still throb with the recollection of it. I found him standing before the fire, with that look upon his face which I had seen only once or twice in our acquaintance, a look which I may call an absolute concatenation of inductive and deductive ratiocination, from which all that was human, tender, or sympathetic was absolutely discharged. He was simply an icy algebraic symbol. Indeed, his whole being was concentrated to that extent that his clothes fitted loosely, and his head was absolutely so much reduced in size by his mental compression that his hat tipped back from his forehead and literally hung on his massive ears. After I had entered, he locked the doors, fastened the windows, and even placed a chair before the chimney. As I watched these significant precautions with absorbing interest, he suddenly drew a revolver and, presenting it to my temple, said in low, icy tones, "Hand over that cigar case." Even in my bewilderment, my reply was truthful, spontaneous, and involuntary. "I haven't got it," I said. He smiled bitterly, and threw down his revolver. I expected that reply. "Then let me now confront you with something more awful, more deadly, more relentless and convincing than that mere lethal weapon, the damning inductive and deductive proofs of your guilt." He drew from his pocket a roll of paper and a notebook. "But surely," I gasped, "you are joking. You could not for a moment believe." Silence.
Sit down. I obeyed. You have condemned yourself, he went on pitilessly. Condemned yourself on my processes familiar to you, applauded by you, accepted by you for years. We will go back to the time when you first saw the cigar case. Your expressions, he said in cold, deliberate tones, consulting his paper, were, how beautiful. I wish it were mine. This was your first step in crime and my first indication. From I wish it were mine to I will have it mine, and the mere detail, how can I make it mine, the advance was obvious. Silence. But as in my methods it was necessary that there should be an overwhelming inducement to the crime, that unholy admiration of yours for the mere trinket itself was not enough. You are a smoker of cigars. But, I burst out passionately, I told you I had given up smoking cigars. Fool, he said coldly, that is the second time you have committed yourself. Of course you told me. What more natural than for you to blazon forth that prepared and unsolicited statement to prevent accusation? Yet, as I said before, even that wretched attempt to cover up your tracks was not enough. I still had to find that overwhelming, impelling motive necessary to affect a man like you. That motive I found in the strongest of all impulses, love, I suppose you would call it, he added bitterly, that night you called. You had brought the most conclusive proofs of it on your sleeve. But I almost screamed. Silence, he thundered. I know what you would say. You would say that even if you had embraced some young person in a sealskin coat, what had that to do with the robbery? Let me tell you, then, that sealskin coat represented the quality and character of your fatal entanglement. You bartered your honor for it that stolen cigar case was the purchaser of the sealskin coat. Silence. Having thoroughly established your motive, I now proceed to the commission of the crime itself. Ordinary people would have begun with that with an attempt to discover the whereabouts of the missing object. These are not my methods. So overpowering was his penetration that, although I knew myself innocent, I licked my lips with avidity to hear the further details of this lucid exposition of my crime. You committed that theft the night I showed you the cigar case, and after I had carelessly thrown it in that drawer. You were sitting in that chair, and I had arisen to take something from that shelf. In that instant you secured your booty without rising. Silence. Do you remember when I helped you on with your overcoat the other night? I was particular about fitting your arm in. While doing so I measured your arm with a spring tape measure, from the shoulder to the cuff. A later visit to your tailor confirmed that measurement. It proved to be the exact distance between your chair and that drawer. I sat stunned. The rest are mere corroborative details. You were again tampering with the drawer when I discovered you doing so. Do not start. The stranger that blundered into the room with a muffler on was myself. More, I had placed a little soap on the drawer handles when I purposely left you alone. The soap was on your hand when I shook it at parting. I softly felt your pockets, when you were asleep, for further developments. I embraced you when you left that I might feel if you had the cigar case or any other articles hidden on your body. This confirmed me in the belief that you had already disposed of it in the manner and for the purpose I have shown you. As I still believed you capable of remorse and confession, I twice allowed you to see I was on your track, once in the garb of an itinerant Negro minstrel, and the second time as a workman looking in the window of the pawn shop where you pledged your booty. But, I burst out, if you had asked the pawnbroker, you would have seen how unjust. Fool, he hissed, that was one of your suggestions to search the pawn shops. Do you suppose I followed any of your suggestions, the suggestions of the thief? On the contrary, they told me what to avoid. And I suppose, I said bitterly, you have not even searched your drawer. No, he said calmly. I was for the first time really vexed. I went to the nearest drawer and pulled it out sharply. It stuck as it had before, leaving a part of the drawer unopened. By working it, however, I discovered that it was impeded by some obstacle that had slipped to the upper part of the drawer, and held it firmly fast. Inserting my hand, I pulled out the impeding object. It was the missing cigar case. I turned to him with a cry of joy. But I was appalled at his expression. A look of contempt was now added to his acute, penetrating gaze. "I have been mistaken," he said slowly, "I had not allowed for your weakness and cowardice. I thought too highly of you even in your guilt. But I see now why you tampered with that drawer the other night. By some inexplicable means, possibly another theft, you took the cigar case out of pawn and, like a whipped hound, restored it to me in this feeble, clumsy fashion. You thought to deceive me, Hemlock Jones. More, you thought to destroy my infallibility. Go. I give you your liberty. I shall not summon the three policemen who wait in the adjoining room, but out of my sight forever." As I stood once more dazed and petrified, he took me firmly by the ear and led me into the hall, closing the door behind him. This reopened presently, wide enough to permit him to thrust out my hat, overcoat, umbrella, and overshoes, and then closed against me forever. I never saw him again. I am bound to say, however, that thereafter my business increased, I recovered much of my old practice, and a few of my patients recovered also. I became rich. I had a brougham and a house in the West End. But I often wondered, pondering on that wonderful man's penetration and insight, if, in some lapse of consciousness, I had not really stolen his cigar case.